is the Irk Russell Show, featuring highlights of Georgia Southern Football 88. Brought to you by Hardee's. We're out to win you over. By Eastern Airlines. We earn our wings every day. By Franklin Chevrolet of Statesboro, home of the Franklin Value. And by Coastal Bank, your personal financial expert. And now here's WJCL sports analyst Bill Edwards.
Good evening again, everyone. Welcome to season number 5 of the 88 campaign, when Georgia Southern today in Tallahassee, Florida, takes on, who is it we're playing?
Florida State.
Florida, okay. We asked somebody that at the airport, and they said, well, you'll find out soon enough. Now, yep. This has got to be our biggest challenge, I would suppose.
There's no question about it. This is probably the biggest challenge that a Georgia Southern football team has ever had. As you know, 2 years ago, we opened the season with the University of Florida, but I'm not sure that their team at that time is of the same caliber that this Florida State team is. They are really good, to say the least.
Irk, this is a wonderful setting. This is the first game I think we played this season, first of all, where the weather has been just about perfect. There is a little bit of a breeze, but that might calm down by game time. But this is a beautiful college atmosphere in College Town, and the weather's just gorgeous today.
We got here just as the homecoming parade was breaking up yesterday. You do realize that this is homecoming,
yeah.
And that this will be a sellout crowd. More than 50,000 people, and again, that's one reason why this is a great opportunity for our kids to play before a crowd like this, and in this setting. And as you said, this is the first time this season that we haven't been sweating out rain, but I don't believe it's going to rain today. This is maybe the first time that I wish that it had, but it ain't going to. But I think our kids are really looking forward to play in this football game. They've given me every indication that they want to play, that they think they can play with these people at least for a while, and I'm looking forward to it too. I can hardly wait until 2 o'clock and to see that ball teed up and kicked off.
Now, I know that a lot of, besides looking forward to the game itself, it wasn't that long ago that Florida State's football program was, I would say, either down in the doldrums or on the par. I remember them playing Citadel and seeing them play Citadel when I was coming up through high school.
Well, I can remember when Florida State was a girls' school, and they couldn't beat anybody in football. They had some great teams in the early 60s, and while I was at Georgia, the first 2 years we played Florida State. They had Tinsley the quarterback, Biletnikoff the receiver. They were going good under Coach Peterson. Things dropped out 10 or 12 years later, but believe me, they're coming back now, and under Coach Bobby Bowden, my boyhood idol, the Seminoles are back on top.
Now, how do we look injury-wise? How do things stack up today?
Raymond Gross is better than he was this time last year. I'm not sure that he's 100%, but we're going to start him. He wants to play, and we're going to see how things go there. Taz Dixon's ankle is better than I thought it might be. He wants to play so badly, I think he has willed his ankle well, and he'll play some today. Other than that, we're in about the same shape, which is not particularly good because we've lost some good players for the season.
Okay, best of luck on our greatest opportunity to date.
Thank you, Bill. It is a great opportunity, and I hope we can play well.
I hope so, too. We'll
see you.
All right, and we'll see you with the first half highlights of the Georgia Southern FSU game after this. Okay, let's face facts. The Florida State program is more established and older and better organized than ours. Just something basic that was hard to overlook Saturday afternoon. But hope springs eternal, and running back Frank Johnson had told us earlier in the week that they'd been practicing hard and they weren't going down to Tallahassee to show up to be beaten. They were going down there to win. And there were those who scoffed. But no one would dispute the Eagles showed up in force. USA Today, prior to the season, had called this the ugly game of the year. Well, I would say Nebraska's 63-10 annihilation of Kansas is not something you'd call a classic matchup that took place this same afternoon. And if the Eagles showed up in force, so did their fans. And there was no disputing their enthusiasm. Nice going. Or their desire to ruin the Seminoles' homecoming party. And the Sigma News were among those who wanted to taunt the FSU faithful when that happened. And when Chief Nakahoma's cousin, Chief Running Back, or whatever this guy's name is, speared the turf, it was time for the Eagles to prove their mettle. And indeed, the Eagles proved they were not going to be knocked over with a feather. On Georgia Southern's first possession, they proceeded to go nowhere fast, but when punter Terry Harbin darn near had his leg amputated by a Seminole defender's shoulder pads moments later, GSC got new life. While Terry was glad he still had his and would live to punt again. And punt again he did on the Eagles' next possession. So when they were forced to give it up, the Seminoles finally got a crack at scoring, and they decided to test the Eagle air defense with some initial success. Quarterback Chip Ferguson hitting tight end Reggie Johnson. But the next test failed when Ferguson's pass ricocheted off the intended receiver right to Rodney Oglesby, who came up with the first of his two skyjackings on the afternoon.
The team as a whole had a great effort. We played great together, and we just gave it all we had. We came into the game knowing that we could play with Florida State, and I think we proved it to a lot of people today. A lot of people thought that we couldn't even come out here on the field with them in the last two or three quarters. But I feel that we proved something to a lot of people.
For various and sundry reasons, Southern couldn't move very far on their third possession either and had to send it back to FSU. And the Seminoles could literally do no wrong this time. No pass that Ferguson threw was uncatchable. Nor were any defensible, as Randall Boone and Terry Young had Ronald Lewis on this play covered like Rambo in a firefight. But he made a spectacular one-handed grab anyway. Incredible. From there, it took one play, Ferguson connecting with Lawrence Dawsey all by himself in the flats, and he was in for what appeared for a while like it might be the only score of the game, as inconceivable as that seemed at the time. FSU knew that they were not playing any ordinary 1AA team. Watch number 56, Michael Berry, come in and bury Chuck Ferguson on the touchdown pass. That's an industrial strength stick in anybody's league. And fortunately, it took the Seminoles a long time to figure out that running on the Eagles was a lesson in futility. As you'll notice, the reverse backfires when running back Lawrence Taylor runs into Darren Alford, Patrick Parr, and Darrell Hendricks. And the Georgia Southern faithful was going crazy. The Seminoles were forced to punt. And that's when the Eagles began their most promising drive of the half, as Raymond Gross pitched to Joe Ross, who turned the left corner and got us to midfield. The drive, however, began to stall, and David Kuhl came on to attempt a 50-yard field goal. Unfortunately, it came up about 5 yards shy of 3 points. Then, just as time was running out in the half, FSU looked like they might take a bigger lead into the locker room, when Ferguson linked up with wide receiver Ronald Lewis for 30 yards. But Eagle defenders like Rodney Oglesby, remember him, would allow no more, stopping tailback Keith Ross for a 6-yard loss and forcing the Noles to go for 3 instead of the 6. But what appeared to be a 31-yard chip shot for place kicker Richie Andrews hooked to the right. And the score was an incredible 7-0 Seminoles at halftime. And we'll be back with the talk of one of those responsible for bringing football back to Georgia Southern, Morris Lupton, our halftime guest after this. With us, Morris Lupton, one of the biggest Georgia Southern supporters that there is, and one of the guys who was one of the people who, I guess you were one of the folks that got the ball rolling, so to speak, Morris, and getting this football program off the ground.
Well, you know, I guess it all happened kind of funny, and with Dale Licht, the enthusiasm he had, he gave us the opportunity and kind of threw the ball out, Bill, and we ran with it from there.
6 or 7 years ago when you were sitting around planning all this, did you plan to be down playing the Florida State Seminoles this quickly?
Good gracious. No, there was no way. Hey, 7 years ago, I was just hoping we would have college football. Nothing like we've got back at home. And certainly we didn't even dream about being down at Florida State.
Now, the first time we played Florida State, we played them a couple of times on the JV, and then we came down here when we were playing club ball originally. That was quite a contrast from today.
Well, yeah, I was sitting over there in the stand right in back of me, and I think we had a total of probably 150 people in here. So, yeah, there is quite a contrast. I know over there right now we've probably got probably 800 to 1,000 people, and they're still coming strong.
This has been we always talk about the phenomenal growth of this program, but it has not only been a phenomenal growth there, the college itself and the support that we have gotten, that we have at Georgia Southern now is just, I would say, as good as any place in the country for a school our size.
Well, and you know, again, I guess what football has done, the enthusiasm and just the growth pattern, it has just, I don't know of another college really has done any more than what we have, Bill.
In fact, all that cheering you hear in the background is not for the Seminoles, that's the Georgia Southern people that are down here.
That's right. Hey, you know, we're kind of small, but I guarantee you they'll know we're here today, crowd-wise and football-wise. I really think that probably in the next 5 years, we're going to see Florida State and Georgia Southern playing us.
I don't see why not. Of course, it must give you, you know, a great thrill, and I know that you were instrumental in helping get the program started, but to look up on that building over there and see your name and Ann's name up there just must give you a kind of a lump in your throat or something.
Well, it does, and you know, and just and seeing all the folks that just have the opportunity to go up and just enjoy it, and you know, that's what it was all about. We had so many people down in South Georgia just didn't have the opportunity of any place to go see college football, and that's what it was all about.
Well, congratulations. Thanks for the contribution you've made, and keep up the good work. It's always a pleasure seeing you.
Thank you, Bill. It's my pleasure.
Okay. Our halftime guest, Morris Lupton, and we'll be back with the second half highlights of the Georgia Southern FSU game right after this.
Hold on to your war bonnets, Eagle fans. You ain't seen nothing yet. The second half began like the first, with Chuck Ferguson completing his first two passes, one to a teammate, Terry Anthony, the second to Rodney Oglesby, who was not. And Georgia Southern was cooking at the Tribe's 30. The Eagles went right to work on 3rd and 7. Gary Miller in for the injured Joe Ross, knifed his way off left guard for 9 yards inside the Noles 20. And when the drive stalled, Mike Dowis stepped in to cut the FSU lead to 4 points with his 28-yard upright splitter. And Georgia Southern fans were sensing an upset. The Eagle defense kept up the pressure like a hydraulic press. On 3rd and 9, Ferguson searched in vain for a receiver and could do nothing but lose 2 yards. And Taz Dixon was among those jumping for joy. Now to the dying minutes of the third period. The Eagles in full flight. Raymond Gross in the pilot seat, firing to Frank Johnson for 22 yards to the Noles 22. And then it happened. First play, 4th stanza. Gary Miller got the call, and the pile driving Augusta senior fullback spun off one defender and went 22 yards to glory through a hole opened by Dennis Franklin and John Wilson. And GSC fans about 80 yards up the field and on the other side were tearing down the grandstands. And there you see it in writing. From there, the Seminoles had to fight back and fight hard. It took them 13 plays and 6 minutes, 5 seconds to erase the deficit, relying mostly on passes in the flats to get the job done. The Seminoles had at last found the Eagles' Achilles heel. And Chuck Ferguson on play number 13 found wide receiver Ronald Lewis in the happy hunting ground for the lead for good.
Well, sometime I wondered, you know, where we were when they were doing that. Right now, I can't tell you where we were, except we weren't in the right place.
We were saying that at least if we were close, we had a chance. But coming into the fourth quarter with a lead, we were really pumped.
How physical were these guys?
Well, to me, I don't think that they were more physical than UT Chattanooga. But as a whole, you know, they had a lot more size and a lot of depth.
You know, the game was a lot closer than the score said.
I know a lot of, you know, hope springs eternal. I know you wanted to win this one, but boy, I tell you, it's not the homecoming they expected.
No, it's not. They expected a little cakewalk, and they expected the score to be like 65-7 or something like that, and, you know, it just didn't turn out that way for them.
You guys look around this far away from home, huge crowd for you, band was here the whole bit.
Yeah, we had the greatest fans in the country. I think you know, they'll follow us just about anywhere, or if not anywhere. And, you know, having them behind us and cheering like they did today, it, you know, really makes us feel good.
To make a long story short, FSU's superior strength and depth finally led to two late TDs to make the score more, shall we say, respectable. But Georgia Southern proved something Saturday. The Eagles can fly with the best. And for one brief, shining moment, we were better than Florida State. The Florida State Seminoles had a very rough time for homecoming today, and Irk Russell, I want to congratulate you and your team. I know you hate to be congratulated for a loss. I know we wanted to win this ball game, but I think up 10-7 midway through the fourth quarter was quite impressive for our boys.
Well, it certainly was, Bill, and I can't say enough about our players and the effort that they put forth. Everybody that played a play, I believe, played as hard as he could play. And it's too bad that we had to play the fourth quarter, or it's too bad that we couldn't have played better in the fourth quarter. We could ill afford to substitute. We played with most of our same people. I guess that's the way you figure Division I against Division I AA, that they'll, if they don't get you in the first three quarters, they'll wear you down in the fourth quarter. But nobody left, did they?
They sure didn't. They said it was the largest crowd in history, I believe.
Well, I don't know about that, but for a game that was billed before the season started as the ugly game of the year, it turned out to be pretty, pretty for three quarters anyway, didn't it? You know the old story about the genie coming out of the bottle and giving you three wishes? I'd use one of them and wish that we played at home. I am so tired of playing away from home that and I think our guys will respond to that.
Look, a superb effort today, and it'll be good to see you back at Paulson Stadium next Saturday.
Thanks, Bill. I look forward to it.
Me too. See you. And we'll see you folks next week as well for the highlights of the Northeast Louisiana game. The last three defending national champs, except there will only be two teams on the field because Georgia Southern has two of those. And we'll see you then from back in Paulson Stadium. Thank God. Thanks for joining us from Tallahassee. Good night.
This has been the Irk Russell Show, featuring highlights of Georgia Southern Football 88. This sports special has been brought to you by Hardee's. We're out to win you over. By Eastern Airlines. We earn our wings every day. By Franklin Chevrolet of Statesboro, home of the Franklin Value. And by Coastal Bank, your personal financial expert. This sports special has been produced by WJCL-TV in conjunction with the Hardee's Georgia Southern Sports Network.